Welcome back to the Mystic Manor for another episode of Optimystic. I'm your host, Brandon Beachum. So happy to be here stewarding the spaceship yet again. We have an incredible lineup of visionary artists. That's always never much of a secret. Floating over here, we have Ashely Josephine tonight. We have... We have an incredible Soulshare interview ahead. We have some incredible musical medicine. We actually have, for the first time, some spoken word poetry that's going to come your way. Going to be good. And before we dive down that rabbit hole, as you guys know, I like to always take a few minutes and just share something that's anything that might be bubbling up in my own life or perspective that's really served me well. And one thing that that kind of popped up for me in the last few days is this idea of I am. We've all heard the famous Bible quote, I am that I am, right? And Moses originally walking up on, you know, the mountain, I think, you know, he supposedly talked to God at the top of the mountain. I wasn't there, can't tell you for sure. I think he might have found a patch of mushrooms on the way, but that's a whole other conversation. And, you know, he's supposedly up on the mountain talking to God and asking God, like, you're telling me these things, what do I tell the Israelites? What do I tell them, you know, which God am I talking to? And he says, tell them I am that I am. And, you know, and he said, went on to say, for this and every generation, I am is the name of God, essentially. And when you start thinking of this being the power of God, when you're invoking, we all use the words I am all the time, every day, right? And you're actually invoking the power of God. I truly believe that. I mean, you know, organized religion may have you know, taken some of these stories, and in some cases, people would argue that they've been hijacked and whatnot. But I think there's a lot of great symbolism and power in a lot of these ancient texts. And so, you know, looking at this one, I mean, how often, how many, everyone in this room today, everyone out there listening, you've probably said, I am something today, right? And, you know, understanding that whenever you say, whatever you say behind I am, whatever follows I am is following you. Right? And so taking that, like, did I say I am sick? I am sad? I am, you know,
sorry, or
I am healthy. I've told the story of being healthy my whole life. Oh, I don't believe in getting sick. I am healthy. I am healthy. Guess what? I've gotten sick, but very, very, very rarely compared to the average person. And so what do I attribute that to? Just a story that I made up. Understanding that by invoking these words, these two powerful words, I am the creator. I mean, when you think about it, if I exist, you take I am that and break it up. I am that I am. Just being. We're all a part of, you know, God is every single thing that you can name. I am that, I am this, I am that. There's nothing that it's not. What part of it all are you going to invoke next is always the question, right? It's all there. It's all at your fingertips. It's all at your disposal. You know, whether you're saying something negative or positive, there's, you know, it's indifferent. It's works as a law, in a sense, that we're all learning. And we're all, of course, becoming more aware of this and being more conscious in our decision to invoke this incredible power. You know, you're writing others, essentially, into your story to conform to the instructions that you're giving them. Another word that is similar, Ohm, same thing. There's a book by David Allen called The Power of I Am, and he talks about all the symbology and, you know, how Mary and, you know, the Virgin Mary represents the same thing. The idea of Christmas, you know, essentially being very symbolic. It represents the human heart or the subconscious, and the Virgin Mary is the infinite conception of self, right? It can continue to conceive itself without the help of man. The you know, Mar itself means the sea, or, you know, essentially is like your stream of consciousness. He talks about the virgin, the word virgin being a mind dedicated to God. The star in that story, you know, the Bible story of the nativity, representing the infinite intelligence within that's always guiding us. And, you know, I am is essentially a gift. That is the Christmas tree, right? It is the gift. There's no work or sacrifice that's needed, right? That's a powerful thing. You know, you have this power. You don't have to earn it. You're all automatically worthy just by being, right? No sacrifice, no work. You can use this tool all day, every day to create the reality that you want to see. And some of us have been doing it unconsciously for a long, long time, and it's time for that to end. It no longer serves us to say, I am all the things that I don't want to be. When you realize you are the creator and created rolled into one, use the power that you've got, right?
Yeah.
The other thing that's important to really think about with this is, you know, only you can say it for yourself. Only you can say, I am whatever you, whatever wants to follow it. People can try and give you an idea of what you are, and you know, oh, you are this, you are that, and you can accept it, and you can buy into it, but you don't have to buy into it. You know, the only one who can really say what you are is you. You have all the power. And that's another thing that a lot of us have been doing. We've been taking the story that someone else gives us. Oh, you are this, you are that, and allowing them to create us. When, you know, really, you're really giving up your power when you do that. And a lot of times we're giving up our power to people who we don't even really necessarily admire or want to model ourselves after, right? It makes no sense, but yet we've all been trained to do it. So we're at a point in our evolution where, you know, we realize we can take the power back. We can start our morning with something as simple as repeating, I am fun, I am fun, I am fun, I am wealthy, I am abundant. Whatever it is you want to say, you're literally just casting spells. Abracadabra means I create as I speak. You're literally casting a spell every time you use and invoke this powerful mantra, right? Why aren't we using it more? Why are we just using it, not really even, it's like wielding our power, you know, without understanding. It's like driving the Ferrari, stopping and starting, you know, never really using it to its fullest. It's like driving it in a neighborhood when you could be taking it on, like, you know, open-ended, no restriction road. And that's what you have at your disposal to do if you decide to do. And I don't know about you guys, but I am empowered by everything. I am choosing to be empowered by everything. When something is challenging me, I am telling the story that, oh, that's happening for me. I'm empowered by this. I'm empowered by what just happened. There's always the lump of coal, there's always a diamond waiting on the other side. And when you start telling that story, everything starts to shift. Now you're using this power that's been lying dormant, waiting. We're all like, you know, these fishermen that have been sitting on the back of a whale fishing for a minnow. You have so much power right underneath you that you haven't been accessing. And it's time for us to take our power back and not give it away and let other people tell us what we are, to say it for ourselves. Whatever follows I am follows you. And we are all doing it. You are all making the difference. You're all getting it. Everyone out there listening to this. And as we start to make this change and to realize how empowered we are, that, you know, if God is that and you are something, guess what you are? Like, you know, there's a book called Three Magic Words. And at the very end of the book, that's, you're waiting for the three magic words. It's like from the 50s. You're waiting, you're waiting, you're waiting. And at the very end, it's like, you are God. That's the three magic words. And it's like, you ready for that or not? I don't know if you're ready for it, but that's what's going on. And you know what? This is what Jesus said when they were about to kill him. Oh, we're going to kill you. You said you're God. Oh, isn't it written in the old text? Ye are gods. So I'm not saying just I'm God. I'm saying you're God, and you're God, and you out there listening are God, and the plants are God, and the trees are God. It's all the same energy. And we have the power to invoke so much more than we've been. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm happy to see what else is hiding in there in the cookie jar for us to play with. And speaking of cookie jars, we've got Ashely Josephine over here depicting some sort of incredible magic. What is this all about?
It's not cookies, but...
It's not cookies.
I wish it was. A lot of people have asked when I started this painting, and I started it in 2011, actually. So a really long time ago, it looked completely different. A lot of times when I paint, it goes through a metamorphosis. And it seems to be that, you know, as we have different life experiences and we become more of who we need to be to finish the painting, you know, it's like a process there. So as you're journeying with it, you might not even be able to take it to completion until you have these different chapters of your life. And so in this one, it initially started out with the intention of being like a goddess alchemy, like an inner transformation into like womanhood. And then it started to grow in, you know, as different life experiences were weaving together. And so in this one of my favorite journeys has a lot of symbolism woven in here. And it was this amazing experience. where I was at a ceremony, and it was definitely mostly men in the room. So I'm saying that because the container that I was in felt very vulnerable for the experience I was going to have. And I didn't know what was going to happen, but I just surrendered it up, and I was, like, overcome by, for, like, hours of, like, blissful kundalini, like, orgasmic downloads. And it was hours of visions and embodiments, you know? So, like, the big cat energy, which I often see, are tigers. And they really represent a lot of what you're saying. You know, they come and really help you with owning your inner authority and not letting other people define you. You define yourself and your creative identity from within. And I was ejecting, like, as I was purging, there would be, like, pixels and all kinds of, like, prisma, ephemera, and energy. And I was ejecting all of this negative programming out of myself.
Wow.
Yeah. And and so, yeah, we were orgasmically taking down Babylon with, like, some fierce...
Some, that's one, like, way to do it.
It was from within, you know? We were just, like, undoing all that stuff, and I just remember laughing and, like, just being, like, you know, verbally purging, like, take it. Like, just, like, take your $10 toasters and your bullshit matrix. Like, I don't want anything but my true self. And it turns out I'm kind of a hot girl, so that was pretty cool. I didn't know that. So getting to define yourself, you get to do whatever you want. Just owning that. And so there were periods of time where I was, you know, between these visions, and I got to see a lot of the transformation of consciousness and the very long period that it's going to take. You know, it's not something we're all going to just necessarily see completed here. We're a part of it. We're like imaginal cells. I don't know if you guys know what those are, but they relate to the butterflies. And when they turn into goop before they even know that they're a butterfly, their whole immune system begins to attack itself. And they don't even actually know that it's their own butterflyness that they're fighting. And so I was seeing our society and our culture, especially in America, as being very much in this war with itself and as it's transforming. And you can see that when you look out there. And there was a lot of peace I felt, because I really felt like this was happening as a natural organic process through us. It wasn't something I needed to control or, like, be in charge of, or, like, get my ego behind it and be, like, right, you know, leading the way. It was just me doing me, everyone doing them, and all of us just, like, trying to be at the eternal party at the end of time together. And so the snakes, I was purring like a cat and hissing like a snake. I was, like, really in it, like, super deep.
That's a kundalini coming up the spine.
And a lot of it meant for it to be kind of an ovary thing, you know. There was an element there of just, like, especially there was a lot about the goddess and about the feminine, and that may just be because that was my experience, you know, for me to have.
Sure.
But yeah, there was a lot of that and healing, you know, the effects of just toxic culture on women and women's bodies and our sexuality. And I remember being taught how, as I was having these waves of, like, orgasmic energy moving through, it was showing me how that heals the environment, that our own energy and our own pleasure and, like, the beauty around that, and when we're treated well and, like, with love and reverence, how that can really help the world. So that's what's going on here.
That's all?
just a big fat download.
This could have some deep meaning.
I know. Just some squirting.
So beautiful. Thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
I love the synchronicity of that. I mean, here we're, you know, I really saw this an hour or so before I had already decided what I wanted to talk about today, and talking about, you know, this virgin and the Virgin Mary and this idea that we, you know, are this infinite intelligence that can, infinite conception of self, like, you don't really need, it's all being birthed through you. You don't, as you said, we don't really need to try too hard, allow it to flow,
just
and allow it to just happen. And of course, the first time we're having spoken word poetry by my good friend Robin Tala, it's actually spoken word poetry dedicated to the goddess. Of course, synchronistically, none of it planned.
None of us knew that.
I think it's a good time for you, my friend, to come up. Take it away.
Yeah. Yes, I'm a troubadour, true decor, blooming for the goddess. Through the door, boom and roar, communing with the prophetess. Fruit she bore, truth restore with a fierceness and a softness. Yet beauty more than e'er before, get ready, cause she rocked this world in her arms like a mother and a baby. Still fire in their eyes, loving with the flames ablazing. She's your mother, she's your queen, she's your sister, and she's seen the depth of human hatred. Still the soul of Magdalene stands strong. Woo! Coming from the line of Isis, set the phallus to a balance, culmination of the crisis to ignite bliss. Her hand is working as I write this. Beautiful and strong, sing a song that's whole and righteous. Woo! Please, God, send us the strength to survive. Blooming through the Kali Yuga, hear the music in the night. Oh, God, send us the harmony and balance. And when the smoke is clear, we'll know the flame inside the chalice. Please, God, send us the strength to survive. Blooming through the Kali Yuga, hear the music in the night. Oh, God, send us the harmony and balance. And when the smoke is clear, we'll know the flame inside the chalice.
Thank you so much for having me on.
Thank you, thank you. Yes, that was absolutely synchronistically divine.
Well, I really believe that it's a very important part of the balance of our world for us men to rise up and to help and assist and support our sisters and our mothers and our daughters and all of the people in the gender spectrum who identify with the feminine energy to create and step into their own empowerment. And so I see you doing that, and I do that as well. And so thank you for providing space for me to bring these words to achieve that.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, my friend. All right, and now it is time for this week's Soulshare guest, Lee Harris. Lee is an energy, intuitive, and transformation guide who offers grounded teachings. He has popular online monthly energy updates and retreats all around the globe that inspire others to bring their unique gifts to the world. Give it up for Lee Harris, everyone. Woo! Lee Harris, so glad to have you here, my friend.
So glad to be here. Thank you for having me.
One of the first people I thought of when Optimystic got kicked off, I was like, Lee is a must-have, and you were so quick to oblige, and here we are. And
it's amazing. So well done to you and the whole team for creating this.
Yeah. So why don't you start by giving us a little bit of background into who the heck Lee Harris is?
Yeah, wow, that's a question. I'm still trying
still
to work.
Working it out.
Every day it changes, right? So I ended up doing work in this field of consciousness because as a kid, kind of my story of sensitivity is that my way of dealing with my feelings that I didn't know how to deal with was to binge eat and to eventually gain a ton of weight and then go through bulimia and kind of eventually came out the other side of it when I was about 17, 18 with a metaphysical awakening. So I managed to start to unpick how I couldn't deal with the world through suddenly realizing there were dimensions far beyond anything that I had previously experienced. But suddenly it was like, oh my God, this makes sense. This world makes more sense, and so does the world of free emotion. So it was kind of, it was going for tarot readings and having really deep physical reactions in those readings that other friends weren't talking about. And it was things like the Oprah Winfrey Show where she had, I was 16 and she would talk to people about their feelings. And I was like, oh my, you know, this is, to me, this was, yeah, I mean, especially in Britain, you know, at that time, because I'm 43 now. So it was a very different time. Mm-hmm. And suddenly the Oprah Show was one of many things that made me able to breathe for the first time in life and kind of have oxygen. So what happened to me then was more surprising, I think, because I was really on a personal development journey and I was a huge fan of like metaphysics and all that kind of stuff. And I was taken to a channeler, but I was skeptical of the channeler because he was a beautiful man. He was really nice, very kind. And I remember having the reading with him and coming away and thinking that the reading was very wise, but I had that natural skepticism of why did he have to have his eyes closed and have a slightly weird voice?
Right.
You know, it's just, because, you know, It wasn't that I didn't believe him. I found that confusing.
Right.
And then, of course, the joke is now on me because...
That's what you do.
Yeah.
Hypocrite.
Yeah, totally. So I'm actually really compassionate around skepticism of channeling. I totally get it. I get it. I was you. And I wasn't looking to channel. I didn't think that would happen to me. Mm-hmm. And I was minding my own business one day on the underground in London mm-hmm. and going through all the kind of problems I had in my head and all my own, you know, self-attack and all the stuff that I had going on. And literally on the left, and still to this day, this is the position I hear them when I speak to them, I heard, "That's a very interesting thought, but you're wrong."
Oh, wow.
And here is why.
Wow.
And it was like, and they explained how what I was seeing and interpreting was, you know, I was kind of focusing on this, mm-hmm. and what they did was they went, mm-hmm. and suddenly I was like, oh my God, like, and my whole body changed. It wasn't just my mind kind of getting the answer, you know, it was like, oh, everything relaxed, and suddenly I was more open again. So that was my kind of initiation with my guides, and yeah, and then 5 years later, I was kind of pushed into doing it as a job, mm-hmm. not thinking anyone would come, and the rest is 15-year history, really.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. It's a fascinating trajectory. It's like, you know, I've heard this story so many times from people that I've had on, you know, Positive Head, or even on this show already, people who are tapping in or able to channel. And it's, you know, how I've always approached it as someone who's never felt like I'm necessarily channeling some other entity or what have you. I've always approached it like you said, with a sense of healthy skepticism. Like, okay, what is the information that's coming through? Yes. Is it any weirder that something would come through you than the mm-hmm. fact that you're sitting there at all? We've just gotten used to the fact that how weird it is that we even exist.
Yeah.
Like, where did we come from, right? So we've just gotten really used to that. So for me, I just am always, you know, what is being said? What is the information? Is it really resonating? Does it feel like profound? And a lot of the time, it just does. Some of my favorite teachers on the planet claiming to channel something beyond them, their mm-hmm. physical self, that is just like, wow, that's mind-blowing mm-hmm. information. Mm-hmm. And people like Rasha and Abraham and Bashar and all, mm-hmm. you know, they're just this incredible information coming through. And then you look at their lives, and they're very well-adjusted, healthy, happy. They're not like, you know, this crazy person running around on the street talking to themselves. It's, you know, it's sort of, for me, it's a validating, you know, for someone who hasn't had the experience of feeling like I'm necessarily channeling. But then there's the other side of that where some people say, well, all art, we're constantly channeling in some way.
Oh, yeah. And funnily enough, for me, songwriting happened about a year before I heard my guides. And I'd been a lifelong lover of music. I had sung as a kid, but I never thought I would write music. Mm-hmm. And a year before I heard them, I started hearing fully formed melodies in the ethers. Often all the lyrics were there. And so in a way, my channel was opening before contacting them anyway. And so now we're channeling our lives every day. And I think for me, you know, I've always said, like, if I died and someone said, you know, by the way, that channeling thing, that was just a construct, I'm like, okay.
Sure.
I don't really care. Like, I've never overly cared about the origin of people's channel. And there are groups of people who do that, and I'm grateful they do because they've recorded all this information. I'm all about the effect. I'm mm-hmm. like, if it
Me
works
too.
For
yep.
you, fantastic. Exactly. I don't care if you're getting it through archery or channeling or whatever. If it's helping you to open to yourself. And the one thing that they've always said, which I see is true, is that the more we learn to open, the more benevolent a force on the planet we become. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't mean on Thursday that will happen if on Monday you're coming out of a wound. You know, you might go through a kind of wrangly phase for a while.
Right.
But if you continue on the path of opening yourself to spirit and to healing as much of the kind of dents and wounds and bruises that we've all taken on because we live here on the planet, then you do start to become a more magnetic and benevolent force for others, whether you are an extrovert or an introvert. You know, mm-hmm. you might do it in very hidden ways, you might do it in very obvious ways. And so that was always the kind of hook for me, because my own ego didn't like the idea of having to come out as a channeler. And even with the book I published this year, it was like, you know.
Mine doesn't either.
Yeah,
no, I always thought, like, no, I'm going to be Brandon. I'm sticking by this. Like, I'm riding this thing out, you know?
You know, for me, it's more having to, because, you know, division is like the thing that none of us really want to see or experience on the planet. anything that's going to be another division. I was like, oh, Jesus, I was fat kid, and then I had to come out as gay, and I was like, not this, you know what I mean?
Now I'm the gay
kid. It was like, now this? You know, it kind of just, it just didn't feel, I was like, really? But then I also see how that has been my growth. It's like, yeah, here's your growth edge, stand for it. If someone talks to you and has a projection on you, that's life. So it's actually been, you know, brilliant, of course.
Yeah, I believe it's also just like relative truths in you know, like this idea that you and I are separate. We can make an argument for that most people would agree with. Mm-hmm. You and I are one. We can make an argument for that. And, you know, there's certainly something that I subscribe to that is actually going on. The consciousness that animates my form is the consciousness that animates your form. The separation between us is illusory. And so these ideas of other beings, even what a lot of people that I've, you know, having talked to a lot of people who are channeling, you know, it's like, oh, these are other versions of myself, right? And at some level, if it's all one, that you are all, you know, there's one of us in the room right now. So it's like, from what vantage point are we speaking? So it really makes it less weird when you start thinking about it like that. Like, oh, we do this segregation thing only so this is how God experiences herself, right? Yes. By taking on different forms and being able to sort of have this contrast. And so from one perspective, it's creating separation. From another, it's just like a fancy, you know, illusion altogether, right?
Completely. And I think that's why, to me, channeling was like a rabbit hole, because when I first started asking those questions, and I would go home every day and I would write questions that were kind of personal and then universal, what I realized was, you know, the more answers you get, the more questions you have. And I think if you approach it from a linear, oh, this is going to help me solve this, this, and this on the earth. No, it's going to take you way beyond the earth, and it's going to continually invite you to an unfolding mystery that we can only see that much of.
Yeah.
So I think that was fascinating for me too. It's like, oh, I see why people with very scientific minds can struggle with this concept, because there aren't finite answers. There are answers that then lead to more questions. And that for me was like, oh wow, this is endless.
And if they're being honest about science, that's the same thing, right?
Exactly.
Like, don't hold on too tight, because that scientific theory or law is all of a sudden gonna get blown up in 5 years perhaps, or 5 days. Yeah. So it's, you know, it's very interesting to see how all that's unfolding for scientists. And I feel like science and spirituality is really doing a dance right now like it never has before.
Yeah, which is great.
It really is. It's really incredible. Yeah. So for you, when you're channeling, who and what, how do they identify? You said they.
So. Yeah, so I said, you know, do you have a name? And they're like, well, we don't have names, but humans like names. So you can call me Zachary. I'm the lead spokesperson. And they explained, they said, we are a group of 88 guides. Mm. And they said, but we then extend wider into source. So they said, in some ways, we're more of a consciousness library than we are fixed beings. Mm. Yes, some of us have been incarnate on the earth plane. Others of us have been incarnate elsewhere, but we come together as a kind of force that we, so in a way it's like they who I'm channeling are channeling, which of course is what we're all doing, right?
Right.
So for me it was never very fixed, because they never explained it to me in a fixed way, whereas I've met people who've gone, oh, I'm channeling this angel, or I'm channeling this. So for me it was a little different. And what started to happen was, the more I worked with them, the more my own intuition kind of went up several notches. So when I'm channeling them, I call them the Z's, because that's what people who followed my work started to refer to them as, because they gave multiple names that all began with Z. So there was Zachary, there was Zyadora, there was Zachariah. And then at a certain point, they stopped differentiating and they said, we're just going back to one voice, because it's most important. Oneness is more important on the planet than division. So we're going to just go back to one voice when I do channel the guides. Yeah.
Interesting. So it's like the zoo, the spirit guide zoo.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. Yeah.
Z, it'll work. All right. Sorry. So
that was like the best moment of this whole conversation so far.
All right, so out of the zoo and back into reality, if there is such a thing. You do energy updates monthly that are quite popular, and I find it really fascinating. Every month when it's a new month, I'm thinking, oh, where's Lee's update? You know, and I it's I'm curious, is that coming through the Z's? Is that something that you're tapping into with, I mean, separately and apart? Like,
I mean, it's all connected, right? So for me, why the energy updates were important was I personally, you know, I could have these enormous experiences, but then integrating the damn thing was like a whole other thing. So yeah. I was really curious about we can absorb higher frequencies, we can have these multidimensional experiences, we can have these big healings, but then it's interesting what the human does with it and what our human aspects, personality, emotions, our energy field, how do we bring that into the body? So for me, the energy update was wanting to kind of give a guide to the people who resonate with how it comes through me as to what you might be seeing showing up in the collective. So it starts very much with the Z's these days. So they will give me three or four headlines and I'll literally just tap in and go, what are the three or four headlines? And then I don't think about it anymore until I turn the camera on and then I just let it come through. And I usually walk away and I'm like, oh, I could have said that. But I now know it's not my place to interfere. It's my place to just put it out there and let it resonate for who it resonates for.
How long have you been doing this?
I started doing them on video in 2012. Oh, and I almost stopped doing them in like 2014, 2015, a couple of times. I was really, I don't know if I want to, it was quite uncomfortable for me to do them years ago. And I've got to the point where I'm able to just switch into it and switch out. But there were times when it was a little intense and I didn't always enjoy it the day after they went out because I would feel really like this while they were on the internet. And luckily I grew up.
It's something that I was thinking about before walking out and doing the monologue. And you and I were talking before, all the whole taping started today. And I was commenting how it's gotten, with each episode, it's just gotten a little easier, a little less prep, less, just more relaxed. And it's like, it's really interesting how with everything in our life, as we grow, we approach that growth edge. At first, it's a little bit uncomfortable, almost always. And when you know that you're going to acclimate, we're meant to be these malleable beings that can stretch. And ultimately, the more you do it, the more comfortable it gets. It's like I sit down with the guests who are going to come out in a bit podcasting. It's always interesting to me because every time they're a little nervous because they've never done it. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I've done this like now in my sleep so many times I don't even think about it. Mm-hmm. Whereas if I think back to episode one, I was probably like, so it's, I think that's an interesting thing just in general for everyone to consider. Like whenever you are feeling that, whenever something excites you and scares you a little bit, know that at first you're going to have wobbly legs, but ultimately we all acclimate, right?
Yeah, I call it contraction before expansion. Mm. So, you know, the example that I always think of is, you know how if you're a kid and you're like excited all week to go to this party and you're like, and the parents are like, oh, she's so excited or he's so excited. And then they take you to the party and you're like this against the wall. And they're like, come on, you wanted to, you know, we kind of, you know, which we all, right? But we all do it. And I think it's twofold. Like I do think it's our own personality or fear, or for me sometimes it's being willing to go in the work I do, it's being willing to become a bit more extrovert, and it's like the tantrum my introvert's having that I'm gonna, you know, go and do a thing with a load of people. But cameras actually I think audience. It's I think it's the energy. So for example, even with something like this, you know, coming here this afternoon, I was quietly at home. It was all kind of like introverted, and I was like, you know, but I now know enough about that reaction. It's like, oh, well, this will probably be good, and it means something expansive is going to happen with these people and in this room. And so it's the part of us that goes like this before we go like this. And I wish someone had nailed that principle for me 10 or 12 years ago when I was doing this kind of work. Because if I'd have just had that in my head back then, I would have saved myself a lot of torment.
That's why I wanted to point it out right now, because I feel like it's such an important piece. A lot of times people will approach and feel that piece and say, oh, yep, this isn't for me, you know, and they don't push through that that growth edge. And for me, I visualized it. It came to me recently as a visualization of what happens on when you're on the beach. You know, you see the tide, it pulls back, and it's like retraction, retraction, and all of a sudden, here comes all the water again. And when you start to understand that energy flows in that way, you can sort of know what you're dealing with.
Yeah, I don't think fear is the problem. I think our inability to manage our fear is the problem. Ah. Or some idea, you know, like people will say, oh, blah, blah, so confident, so fearless. And it's like, no, they're not fearless. They just know when the fear swells that another part of them or the support they have in their life or their experience allows them to go, oh, this is a bit uncomfortable, but I'm just going to go a bit forward and I know it will be. I think that's all it is. And I everybody I've ever met who is doing something courageous, whether it's like leaving their marriage or whether it's, you know, something they do in a more public arena in their community, or everybody I've ever met, if you really talk to them, that growth edge, that crackle needs to be there when we're doing big stuff. And I think that's one of the myths that we were kind of sold. I used to look at people in the public eye and think, oh wow, they've, you know, look, they're, and it's not true at all. Right. Like, if you really talk to them about what they're going through,
they power through.
So yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I heard it said the only thing, and I can't remember I can't attribute it to who said it originally, but the only thing to fear, you know, of course we've all heard the only thing to fear is fear itself. And maybe it was Tony Robbins, the only thing to fear is the fear of fear. Mm. And that one really hit me as an interesting, like, we're scared of being scared. And really it's like being scared to do your homework. Once you sat down to do it, it wasn't nearly as bad as what you thought it was going to be, right?
And yet, isn't it interesting that horror movies are like some of the most popular movies right now? Right. And they're the ones that, you know, I'm really interested in movies and kind of what they do in culture.
Me too.
And like, everybody's going to see horror movies and they're very low budget to make. So studios are like pumping them out. And I'm like, this is fascinating. People want to be scared in a nice, contained environment.
Right.
So it's like there's something in us that knows that fear is part of our life. But, you know, some people seek it through horror movies and other people through, you know, going balls to the wall in their life.
Right. So with your energy updates, I'm curious, you know, obviously it's always very interesting to tune in and see what's happening that month. As someone who's always so interested in like I find myself so interested in like the bigger picture, like where are we going to be in 100 years? Or where was I 1,000 years ago? Who are you to me in a past life? Whatever. I always want to know like this more expanded view. So I'm curious how that piece plays out for you with having, you know, this sort of perspective that you have.
Well, I remember being very triggered. I saw the internet movie Zeitgeist, and then 3 years later, I saw Zeitgeist's friendlier cousin Thrive, which many of you know. It's like, this is the one that terrifies you, and this is the one that scares you, but then shows you there are solutions.
Right.
It's like, I'm glad this one came out a few years later. And I remember being very triggered, through that whole period, and it was definitely a kind of breakdown of some of my belief systems of what the world was at the time. And you know, I channeled a lot with them around that, and they were always like, no, don't worry, there are things that are going to play out in the next few decades that are going to happen over a very long period of time. Much of this is going to be averted, some of it is going to come to the surface, but they were always really adamant about it. And I mean, I go back to 2011 as a time when there were a ton of predictions. Like everybody was like, oh, this is going to happen in March. And, you know, and I had intuitive friends who I trusted who'd be like, oh, you better. And I'd be like, oh God, you know, am I missing the point here? And they were always right. They've kind of said that this period that we're in now, so especially this period to 2024, is really key. They've always said the question is how much damage and how much loss has to be here in order to make the transition. But they're always saying, no, humanity is making a huge transition. And the question is not, will it make the transition? The question is, how messy will it get before you get there? And one thing they've said over the last few years that feels very true to me is they say, you have no idea how much better it is now than it could have been.
Really?
Were timelines different? Mm-hmm. And I've started to see evidence of certain things that they've said beginning to appear in popular, you know, kind of culture. And so it's always interesting because I always surrender to the fact that I am one of many ants on the planet. And, you know, it is a mystery, but it's interesting when I hear what they will say about where we're going and why we're going through this period that we're going through. It's always very interesting and very on point for me.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any, when the information comes to you, does it come visually? Is it like you're hearing?
Yeah, you know? I'm a little bit visual, but I'm very word and feeling based.
Okay.
Which is why for me, I can be very empathic as an intuitive. So if someone is in front of me, I tend to get a sense of how they're feeling, what they're feeling, and how that's syncing up with their psyche. And that's not something I turn on all the time because it would make life annoying. But it is something that I can turn on and I can target when I want to and when I need to. But words, it's very word-based for me. Words and feelings.
Cool. Yeah. So have they given you any, okay, so you're saying up to 2024, how about, has there ever been like, okay, Lee, we're going to give you like the full, you know, it's like you said you love movies. Okay, sit back. We're going to give you the download on what, you know, 2388 looks like. Or
no, I think two, sorry,
put
Brandon.
In the call.
Sorry,
please,
sorry.
Come on. We got popcorn.
Yeah. But I'll send you an email on Monday. No, and they're very, it's interesting because they're very cautious about timeline information. There was one thing they said you have to be careful how you can get co-opted around timelines. So they basically talked about if enough of us believe a story that's going on that has been planted, we will help to make it happen. So you know, that was like a huge wake-up call for me about 7-8 years ago. So I'm very mindful of what I see, and if I notice my own reactions, I kind of process them and kind of come back to whether I think this is true, is this true, is it all a little bit true, but I can choose how to influence it in my life and be part of the collective influencing it. So no, they talk about the timelines being open, and they talk about things are changing all of the time at such rapid speed. So they can't give concrete, they can't say, no, in 2030 it's gonna look exactly like this. But some of the things that they have talked about for this period we're in now, which wasn't thrilling but isn't too surprising, they talked about health. They talked about human health in the coming decades and how that's gonna be a challenge area, but that's gonna be an area that will expose a lot of why there are so many health issues on the planet. And so it's that kind of awkward knife edge thing of things often have to get messy for us to understand how to tidy up the mess underneath. So
Right. Very, very interesting. So you do workshops and retreats and you know, I guess you have quite a few that I've taken a quick look at, and what out of the ones that you've done have resonated the most, do you feel like?
Well,
and why?
It's interesting. We do an annual retreat called Soul Magic, which is 7 days, and it's in Costa Rica. And that definitely is I would say a real launch pad, because not only do the people who come, we kind of look at the year ahead. It's interesting. I will channel, but we'll also just do a lot of work on where are you going and who do you want to be in the next year. So that's always an interesting map for me of kind of the themes of the year ahead. But I would say recently I have a course called Empaths versus Narcissists. The subtitle.
The showdown.
Yeah. And people tried to talk me out of that title, but I was like, no, that is the title. And the tagline is a power dynamic and how to recover from it. And that's a course that I launched kind of reluctantly. I didn't really want to tackle that topic, but it was so much in the work I was doing with personal clients. I used to do a lot of one-on-ones, and it was something I'd had experience with. You know, I'd kind of fallen out of a few heavily empath, narcissist, imbalanced relationships in my life. So it was interesting. It just was a course that really resonated with a lot of people, and we're running it live again, and I'll probably relaunch it next year. But I didn't really think about that topic showing up in the collective when we were creating that course as much as, of course, it has over the last couple of years. So just this place that we give our power away. And it's not so much about overly diagnosing the narcissist or focusing on the person who may have either been a true narcissist in your life or your own behavior had allowed them to take a bigger piece of the pie. It's more about where do we get ourselves embedded in patterns with other people where we are giving too much power to one very questionable driver in the car, rather than both sharing the wheel. So that has been a topic that I would say has shown up a lot in my work. That and boundaries, which is a very controversial one in the spiritual arena, because of course people are like, but I just should be open and love everybody. And I'm like, yeah, you can get there.
It's all one, but come over here.
Yeah, let's just check where your boundaries are too, because if you you can really be open when you know what your boundaries are, and to know that boundaries will change and be fluid, but to be able to have them is really important. And it's something that I've seen and experienced a lot of suffering with in the consciousness field. So yeah, I think that relates back to the work of boundaries in order to let us be as open as possible.
It's interesting when you take these challenging figures that I think everyone's dealt with, someone who's very narcissistic, probably everyone out there has had an experience or been that person and recovered from it, hopefully. And, you know, when you sort of understand that these people are also there as a tool for you to really understand where to put your boundaries, and they're helping you, you know, I think for me that really helps to, you know, bring forgiveness into, you know, the equation, which is necessary to sort of heal from an experience.
Yeah, and I think also one of the things I really didn't get in my own life for a long time is, you know, if you are coming from an empathic place, and sure, you know, we can all be narcissistic, a bit more closed, a bit more defended, we're all gonna go through a spectrum, but if you generally come from a place of, I want to connect, I want to be open, you can kind of, you know, take on projects of other people that is far too big for you to, you are not the person who is going to be their medicine. You might be a part of it, but there's also a kind of ego in that too, that the empath has to kind of reckon with and go, oh my God, I was not willing to let this relationship end with a fracture. I was determined, so I stayed in the ring far too long, thinking that I could be the one that could bring all the light to this. And I think that's a really painful, grief-inducing lesson. Mm-hmm. And it's hard, and it kind of hurts. But if you're willing to kind of go, oh my God, if I let this go, where is my energy going to be welcome? And also investigate why it's more comfortable for me to be the one sending my energy this way than it is to have someone coming to me, sending energy to me. And sometimes it's trauma, and you know, we all have the ability to overcome our traumas, to overcome the parts of us that have held us back from having really beautiful connections with people. And it's ongoing work. But I think for a lot of empaths too, there can be that, you know, you can be the unwanted healer in the room. It's like, you know, everyone else is going, I wish she would just retire that. And I wish she would just talk to me about something else. Right. But, you know, sometimes people are determined. Yeah. So
no, you're getting better.
Yeah, exactly. It's a really interesting dynamic. So it's very complex. And that's why I think, you know, that's why I think this course that I created, when I started, I mean, ended up being like 15 hours of videos.
Wow.
Because there are so many dimensions to it. So, yeah, it's a fascinating topic for all of us, I think, to look at.
Well, you also did one about owning your self-worth, correct? Which really ties into that as well, right? I mean, how many people out there are, you know, the amount of people that I hear, and of course, having retreat guests come through all the time, I realize there's so many people that I sit down with or connect with who there's blockage of not feeling worthy.
Yes.
You know, and I think those narcissistic relationships probably happen more frequently to someone who's in that space or helps to keep someone in that space.
Yeah.
So I'm just curious what you're...
Well, it's interesting because you were a part. So I created this event called Impact the World, and it was something I felt really compelled to do. It was a little bit of a tangent for me, but I wanted to... I found that when I would go for dinner with friends who were in this field, I would end up talking to them about the work they were doing and the nuts and bolts of how they put the work out into the world. Because I find it so creative, like making things happen. You know, sure, you can be a visionary, but if you're not an architect and a builder, nothing's gonna happen. So I was really fascinated to help people who perhaps were great visionaries, but were too scared to architect their work into the world, or they were great architects, but they hadn't worked out that you're never gonna be the one to edit the video because it's just your ADHD is getting in the way of the editing, and that's okay, but let's kind of recognize that and let's find the person who can edit for you. Oh, but I don't know if my video is good enough, so self-worth was stopping them. And so when I did this Impact the World training, I remember the two modules that really triggered the room, because we did a kind of inside the entrepreneur's body and outside the things that you do in the world and how you put it into the world. And it was money, and it was all about the money around their work, and it was all around working and hiring a team mm-hmm. and working with teams of people. And I, you know, that blew my mind because I went into this presenting like 24 modules. I had guest speakers, you included.
Right.
You were fantastic, all about podcasts and what a podcast is in essence and how to do it. And it blew my mind that, you know, this brave group of souls who'd come from all over the world froze when we talked about money and when we talked about teams. And I was like, oh, okay. So mm-hmm. I ended up creating Own Your Value as an online course because I thought, oh, this is a key foundational issue for us. And I, you know, I get it. I think back to the early days of me doing this work and I was always wanted to be validated by like Hay House or somebody.
Right.
And
right.
I never was. So it's right. like, well, now I'm thrilled because right. I kind of am able to own what I do. And I'm able to employ the team and we're able to calibrate the vibration that we want and to put free stuff out there. And the people who pay for stuff pay for everybody's wages and how we put it out into the world and the level of production that I want behind it. So, but it's interesting because if I had been allowed to not own my value early on, mm-hmm. I would have let someone else kind of represent me. And I'm really glad I didn't. I'm really glad that the universe said, no, you're staying on your own and you're gonna learn it the hard way. But in the end, it will be better for you.
Right. Yeah. See, that's huge. So many people feel like, okay, I need to go and get, you know, this big validating sponsor behind me or some big name. And you just, those days are over. The world is like, just even in the last decade, you have a direct line to the entire world. Like, you need that so much less than we ever have. I mean, maybe in the 50s, if you're going to get on the, you know, get your music heard, you had to go through a certain channel. Not anymore. And so it's really empowering to know that, you know, you getting into your authentic best and brightest self, and it's going to find the people that are a vibrational match.
Completely. And it goes back to what we were saying earlier, which is be willing to be scared, but don't let the fear stop you.
Yeah.
So, you know, one of the examples I give in the Impact the World program is don't worry about your production value or how many people you're reaching. You know, if 22 people have watched your video, that's 22 people. Like, imagine 22 people standing in front of you. That's amazing.
That's brilliant.
And I think a lot of people go, oh, well, I'm not quite ready. And, you know, one of my favorite people in the last couple of years, we have dementia in my family, and it's this woman on YouTube who has really low production quality on her videos. And I'm so grateful to her because her information is brilliant. She has stuff to help families with dementia, and I have watched so many of her videos, and, you know, but yeah, the production quality isn't there, but it doesn't matter because she's got a really important message. So she's got loads of us watching and grateful to her because she's helping us. And so I think that's it. It's like, just get in the pool and start swimming.
Yep.
Don't worry about your bikini, how it looks. Don't worry about dredging the pool. Just start swimming and things will start to happen. And I think we all need to hear that. Like, we all have our fear moments or fear days, and we all need someone to just go, come on, just do it. So
That stops a lot of people, is that I've got to be the best, most perfect, mm-hmm. you know, professional, whatever, before I even start. And it's like, actually, you get to that point by practicing and by putting yourself out there. And you know,
and you will probably never think you are the best or the, because that's not how it works. So you'll go, Oh, next time I'm going to, you know, mm-hmm. because that's the path of the creator. It's like you learn every time how to refine. So, yeah, it's all in the eye of the beholder. And the way we see ourselves is usually a very cracked mirror.
Yeah, I like to say perfect is the enemy of good enough. And, you know, do something that's good enough and start moving. And momentum will build and more energy will flood in, more, you know, we respond, right? We take feedback and that gives us more information. If you're sitting on the sidelines thinking about getting in the pool forever and just adjusting your bikini, then, you know, you never have the chance to really learn how to swim. So.
Well, and even this, like, I think what you're doing with your team here, you're creating an experience for all of us in this room that will be very different for anybody who's watching it, but that's another experience. So
right.
I always say, you know, focus on the experience you have.
Right.
Because you'll never look at something you've created or been part of and see it the way someone who wasn't there or wasn't in it will feel. You know, I'm a huge fan of Kate Bush, a British singer-songwriter.
Oh, yeah, she's great.
And one of the best things I ever saw was an interview with her where they, you know, in England, she's kind of considered a genius musically. And they said, oh, you know, what's your favorite song? She said, yeah, I'm never happy with anything I do. And I was like, I just, you know, I was like, huh? Like, it blew my mind. Great. And then I was like, remember that, Lee. Yeah. Like, you know, she will never, ever be grateful to herself the way you and many other people are grateful to her. But right. That's okay, because she's having her experience of being the creator.
Right. Wow. So, before we end up bringing out the Mystic Manor guests, I was thinking, if you'd be open to it, I would love to hear from the Z's. Hopefully they're not mad at me for calling them the Zoo earlier.
They're so mad.
I would love for them to come on stage and have a little chat.
They're going to tell you who you're going to be in, when was it, 2388?
Yeah, you remember the year.
I have a feeling you might be the only one of us back.
Yeah, probably.
I think you love the Earth so much. I think you're going to look the same.
And everyone's
going to
be at the Zoo.
You're probably going to have some kind of show on a spaceship. Yeah.
Everyone's going to be at the multidimensional zoo laughing at me, sitting here all alone.
You'll be channeling all of us in this room. We'll be your guides.
Yes, there it is. The future zoo. Thank you, guys.
Good, welcome. It will take a moment or two to calibrate Lee's frequency to us, but we would first like to begin by saying you are all loving, open souls, and that is the currency of the future. Yes, we understand there are many other aspects of your personalities that you are having to evolve right now, and to some degree, go through a chrysalis phase on Earth as humanity. For yes, there is much in the way of shadow and dark and conflict energy on this planet, but those of you who are capable of cultivating open, loving energy toward the world at large, even if you are not flowing that energy in an enormously benevolent way to the person standing directly in front of you, you are needed, and this is your time. For you will see that the custodians of this planet and the energy transformation that this planet is going through will be those who are capable of holding love, compassion, and strength. But this may look like the fiercest activist you have ever met. And when you will realize this activist is working on behalf of the justice of love, you will understand that compassion as a force is what is required on your planet. And we say this not to diminish any of you who have the great intellect that will be part of building your new future. But we say it to remind you all that fully fledged and open love and compassion are the very medicine that this planet needs in order to raise its vibration. And if you yourself doubt that you are highly operational in these frequencies, we challenge you to recognize you are lying to yourself. And we understand why you would be lying to yourself, because you have all been born into a world that asks you to lie to yourselves over and over about the truth of who you are as energy beings here. And you put on your human suit, which is more than just a body. It is actually a frequency of energy field that is allowed by the other human beings. And you walk around the world trying to bring as much love and energy to the planet as you can. Well, we will tell you that this next few decades, everything is set to amplify on planet Earth. And just as some of you have been a little distressed and had to, shall we say, recalibrate your bodies to the level of chaos that you are seeing emerging and rising on the planet, we would like to point out to you that that very chaos is the fire that will sit underneath your feet where love is concerned. So you cannot have one energy rising without all energy rising. So try not to be too dismayed by what you are seeing in the chaotic or challenge side of this Earth. It is not to say put your head in the sand, and if you are one who is an activist for a very direct problem that you can see on the planet right now, then by all means dive headlong into being the solution. But we would ask you all to remember to sit back and stand back and breathe into your hearts this extraordinary love and compassion that you all have access to. Because as you learn to reactivate it inside your body, you share it and emit that light for others. And that is all it takes. Yes, we know many of you are quite marvelous in what you do on Earth, but it is actually who you be that is what is most required in the years to come. And for many of you, your doings on Earth will allow you to radiate that frequency. But all you are trying to do is to light up every other soul that you meet with light. For there is a war on this planet between what you term light and dark. We would say higher and lower frequencies. And there has always been a war, and yet, within that war, there is also a great love. You see, those who love war. They are not coldly going into war, they are activated by the experience of war. But the frequency is quite low, so you do not see it as the kind of love that is of a high frequency, a love that is benevolent and giving, that generates warmth, that generates light. So try to stay a little clear of getting too separatist in the way you see others on the planet. And the more you can focus on who you are and who you are being and what you are emitting, particularly in the next 6 to 10 years, you will find you will have a quite miraculous experience of the frequency on Earth. For as much as the doom and gloom story abounds at this time, and there is much to, shall we say, grieve or adjust to on the planet at this time, there is also an enormous wave of light and love and compassion. And that does not mean you will see that in the face or the action of everybody you meet. And there will be great areas of the planet that you can see right now where people are far from that frequency. But understand that you taking an action in their direction or in any direction that holds great love and great compassion is felt through the butterfly effect. There is a ripple at work on your planet. And for those of you who see yourselves as what some of you call light workers, others call awake souls, others call beings of consciousness, understand that this personal journey that you are on is actually a collective journey. So your growth and your opening to higher frequencies is you becoming a vessel of that touch paper for others. And that, dear ones, is enough. Many of you grieve being on the Earth, for you wonder why this place is so dark, when you remember everything being lighter and brighter. And what we are here to tell you is the light exists here very strongly. The challenge for you as human beings is to find it, to amplify it, and to let it run through your body, regardless of the reactions of others around you and their comfort or discomfort at who you are being in any given moment. And this is the part of the human suit that is tricky. Human suits are magnetic, which means you are tribal in nature. And there is a truth to this. There is a higher frequency in your tribal nature that allows you to be telepathic. It is why you experience synchronicity. Those are the higher parts of you tuning in on the grid that you are all connected to. But if you go all the way down the scale to where the lower frequencies exist in the human consciousness field, you will also feel those like great anchors. Meaning if you are put with somebody who is cold and defended, it will take the strongest among you and the most heart-activated among you and the most open among you to hold your own frequency rather than going into a more cold or defended state in yourself. So understand what we are saying here. It is not that we are saying you must simply be open all of the time. Instead, we are saying that if you continue to cultivate light and openness and seek places where you are able to access those frequencies, much of the challenge area in your personal lives and in the effect that you have on the collective will start to dissolve naturally. So we do understand that your human suit magnetism will sometimes magnetize you to very challenging, difficult problems with other beings, situations that some part of you is resonant with, either from this lifetime or another lifetime. You will get down in the mud, as it were, because you need to learn from the mud. But we say this to those of you who are beginning to recognize you are getting down into the mud a lot less often these days. And that is because you are able to move at the speed of light more than ever before. and that speed of light is what is more available on your planet in this last couple of decades than it has been for a very, very long time. So for those of you who are harnessing that, understand you are gardeners of heart and light for others. And as you fertilize the light within yourself, you also allow it to fertilize in others. So choose where you focus more of the time and be willing to understand that even though you are in this, shall we say, challenging and chaotic time for planet Earth, for many of you, your experience of the coming years and decades is going to be quite, quite golden. In peace and in love to all.
That was amazing.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Whew. With that being said, I think it's a good time to bring out the incredible guests that we've had this week here at the Mystic Manor, who are brave enough to come out on stage and mix it up with the two of us. So yeah, give it up for this week's Mystic Manor guest, everyone. We have Amy from California. Kabir, maybe from Mars or Arkansas. We're not sure. And Kristen from Bertha the Beautiful Bus. Oh, welcome, you guys. So good to have you on stage on this
Happy
side.
Happy to be here.
Yeah. So here. You got to hear Lee and the Z's here a moment ago. Any particular question or, you know, you've got your moment to talk to this incredible teacher and,
yes.
You know.
Lee, thank you. Yes, you're so amazing. Through my process here, I did a wonderful QHHT session, hypnosis therapy session. And something that I think a little bit personal for me was almost an inability to cut cords. And so it reminded me of attachments and that these attachments that are so seemingly important and just deep within me. There's a fear for sure of letting go, and how do I get past all of that to be able to let go of that attachment to get where I need to be?
It's interesting because as soon as you started speaking to me, you weren't speaking to me, but as I was listening to you sharing about your week, I just had this word going above your head, which was leader, 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 leader.
Wow.
And, you know, I think to some degree we're all leaders in our lives, but with you there's a whole other thing going on with that word. And it's what I get from you is this kind of tough, not always comfortable, but occasionally very graceful initiation period that you're in your life right now. And I think one of the hardest things for leaders is attachment, because as a leader you will sometimes walk 25 steps ahead of everyone else with confidence and say, hey guys, we need to come this way, and have to be able to stand there while you can feel that some of them are doubting you, not trusting, they're in fear, and to be able to put your momentary attachment with them aside to trust the bigger mission of the leadership, and to be able to hold the strength of, I know you're freaking out right now, but trust me. And so for you, what I get is that this is like a maturing phase for you. This isn't actually about attachment to any of those people or person that you are currently working through. This is about you learning that you have constant attachment with everybody if you choose to, but that certain attachments to other people can be our downfall and can stop us accessing our own power. Because if we're centered and we're in our power, we can just trust that even those icky, difficult moments with people, they will resolve and they can be resolved. But it's interesting, like I feel one of the things that hit me with you, so I don't know you or your life, so I don't know how this shows up for you, but it's very strongly rooted in female and feminine leadership. And I say that to you not just because you're in the female form in this lifetime, but there's something really key there around trapped energy, unrealized potential energy that you are going to be the leader of in your life that perhaps hasn't always been able to come through your line. Mm. And so for you, the attachment is empathy. It's like your ability to connect. Really important for a leader, but equally really important for a leader to be able to go, okay, this is where I have to come back to me and stay here and hold the vision and trust that their wobble is not something I have to soothe in this moment. I just have to stay in the strength and let them go through their wobble and their discomfort. So in a way, you're reverse learning it right now. You know what it's like to freak out about something that you can't get back, or that circumstances won't rearrange themselves so that this part of you that's freaking can be soothed. No, this part of you that's freaking is going to calm down and ultimately learn, oh, it's okay, I survived. Mm. That didn't kill me. Mm. And that's what you're going to impart to others as a leader.
Mm. Wow, thank you.
Yeah, I think...
it's incredible.
I think it's really important to note whenever you are worried or, you know, for me, I'm a very nostalgic person. So letting go of someone or something that I'm attached to is, it can be challenging. Maybe, you know, I definitely see myself as somewhat of a leader, and I also see myself as sometimes having trouble letting go of things or attachments to people or whatever it may be. And when you start realizing, what really serves me well is realizing, like, hold on, I am one with the creator. I infinite abundance. Like, whatever it is that I loved in this thing that is now behind me, the universe, source, higher self, whatever you want to call it, can bring it to me in an infinite and myriad of ways. Even more so, whatever I liked about that, and then plus, and even better, you know, this or something better, and it just keeps leveling up. So it's never a loss. You know, it's just like your life is going to continue to just, you know, and so, a lot of times people get in the exact opposite mentality, which is, oh my gosh, I'm too old, I'm never going to get it that good again, or whatever the story might be. And of course, they're saying, I am, you know, exactly not abundant, I'm not, you know, I'm not worthy of more. And I tell the opposite story. And so it really helps me to sort of move through and release those things. It's like, okay, freed up energy. That was as good as that was. Wow, something better than that? Mm-hmm. Whoa, here it just keeps going. It keeps getting better and better. So
yes,
it helps me a lot.
I am worthy.
You are worthy, indeed. Yes, you are, girl. All right, Kabir the Magician. So any questions bubble up? Anything that, you know, you'd like to ask Lee or myself now that you're up here on stage?
I have blocks with confidence I would like to try to work through, that I'm working through, but I would like some more guidance with.
The thing that hits me with you is you have enormous integrity, mm. like enormous. And that can be, what I get is that because you're very sensitive and you're very sensitive to the world, it can be disappointing to have that much integrity and to not always have that be mirrored or respected. And so there's definitely some stuff there for you that, you know, we all have our personal healing, you know, the stuff that has wounded us. And for you, it feels to me that you're still kind of moving through some of those layers. But I also think you are far more confident than you realize. I think it's more that you are just so supremely sensitive to the fluctuations with people in front of you and around you that it's learning to be with what you're feeling in those fluctuations and not have it affect you. So for example, earlier when we were talking, you know, I was talking about the paradox of we show up and do something, but we're not necessarily walking there confidently. You know, we might be, oh, I don't know if I might just want to stay in my robe at home and not go and do Brandon's show, because then I can just be quiet and be an introvert and just watch, you know, watch something or whatever. But it doesn't mean we don't go, but it also doesn't mean we're walking in with full confidence. So what I get for you is knowing your caliber and holding your caliber and knowing that you come with an enormous amount of integrity, and it's very developed in you, and it's not that developed in many people that you meet. And so to kind of own that as a value, and that your presence, your kindness, your integrity, those are things to be valued. And if they aren't being valued, find the places where those aspects of you are, because you have a very bright light in you, and people want to fuck with that sometimes. You know what I mean? People do.
Yeah.
So it's a painful lesson.
Guess we're not gonna go in prime time.
Sorry.
So be it.
Sorry.
I'm with you.
People want to fudge with that.
Yes.
So I think that can be a heartbreaking thing for a sensitive person, but there comes a point when we go, oh, that just happens in the world. And we kind of make peace with the fact that that happens in order to go and find the places where that isn't happening and go and forge new relationships. So to me, that's kind of the turning point you're at, the kind of edge in your life of allowing yourself to receive the good stuff. And I think that's as simple as just repeatedly intending it and paying attention to where people are being not so good. And monitoring, oh, I'm not going there again. Or, no, I've given that person three chances. There can sometimes be a gap when we move away from some of those people, and it can feel empty, but we need that emptiness before the new people can come in.
Right. Yeah. Thank you, that sounds...
Yeah, we talked about this yesterday. You know, on Fridays, I spend a full day with these guys and drop in individually for a while with each one, and we talked about this very thing, you know, confidence and... And what was so funny to me is, as we're talking, I'm like, you know, everything that I've gotten to know and see about you is like what a worthy person you are, how thoughtful and kind and you know, fun and funny. Your laugh's my favorite thing ever. And, and you know, then you would turn around and say something and, in feedback as we're sort of having our exchange, and I'm like, everything that you're saying is like so spot on intelligent. And yet then you're questioning your intelligence. And I'm just like, what's going on here? Like, it's a challenging thing to see in someone that you can see it, and it happens so often, you can see it in them, and they're still not fully seeing it in themselves. And once you fully see it in yourself, it's like, you know, the sky's the limit, because you know, like he said, those things, those values that you have and those that you represent, they're the best of the best. Like, and there is nothing more worthy than, you know, someone who has that integrity and kindness and gentleness and sense of humor and all the things, man. Mm-hmm. So you're doing it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I appreciate that.
All right. Guess who's up? Kristen, it is your turn. How are you?
I'm good, Brandon. Thank you. Aww. I feel so blessed I've had this week here. It's been amazing.
You have definitely been a blessing to this house.
I can't even it's hard to describe a spiritual experience. Like, I got the calling to come here, and I was like, there's the fear, but the excitement too. And now I'm here, and this part right now is the real growth edge for me. To really just sit here and talk like this and be present is huge. It's a great opportunity. How lucky are we if we step into that, you know? And so I feel extremely blessed. Also, you know, the fear is starting to slip away just even as I say this. And really excited about what I get to do next in my life. Brandon really opened my eyes too. So I came to a place where I'm really pretty satisfied. I could, you know, I drive a bus all over the place and it broke, well, there was an accident on the freeway and I got stuck at a McDonald's for like 6 hours. And I was fine because I can just sit and be happy. But it's come to my awareness that there is so much more now. I can call in and become and, you know. So I felt like Kabir's...
You got
Rocket Man.
Thank you.
This dude, this magic wizard guy, his question was kind of the same as what I would have.
What you're just saying is a really great point. It's what we talked about yesterday. It's like, mm-hmm. you know, I kind of sit down and say, hey, where have you been? You know, where are you at now? Where would you like to go? And let me just drop into your world for a moment and see, you know, give you my perspective and what's coming up for me. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of like, I'm very content. Mm-hmm. I don't need a lot. I'm happy to sit at a McDonald's for 6 hours if that's what it is. I'm in a very peaceful state. And she meant it. And what we talked about is like, you're in this clear receptive state where you can call in so much more if you would like. Like you're, you know, all of these guys are so clear. And it's like that's fertile ground for like so much more.
And I'm available and open to it. I'm not attached to anything right now except for Bertha. My bus, you know, she's my
woman.
She's
your chariot. So.
She's my rolling womb, I call her.
You know, it's, I mean, it's beautiful, like the way you describe your experience of life and presence, I think is beautiful and aspirational for so many. And the thing that I just get for you, the word that keeps coming is seer. She's a seer. And part of her knows she's a seer. And part of her is yet to discover that side of herself. I feel like in the next 1 to 2 years, that's going to really birth in you in a big way. Because I feel like you already know you are a seer, but I feel like there's a whole other level about to beautifully wallop through your body in a very welcome and prepared way. Because you're like the most ready for childbirth of anyone I've ever met. Like, you know what I mean? It's like, wow, she's like ready for the baby to come out and she's like, everything is prepared. So that's a kind of nice, that's a nice thing. And I don't know what that will lead to for you because I almost don't want to encourage you to leave this bliss zen state of I'm fine in McDonald's for 6 hours. But but at the same time, it's interesting that that was the thing that's just hovering above your head for me. It's like, yep, she's about to reclaim this aspect of her heritage. So I don't know how that will show up for you or what you will do with it, but it's really there. It's like, oh, cosmic warrior seer is about to birth.
That sounds a lot funner than like an apple pie at McDonald's. I don't know about you guys. Wow.
Yeah.
This has been beyond words. I've had such an amazing time with each of you. Thank you guys for showing up and being brave enough to like co-create this incredible experience. Lee, thank you for coming and
thank
sharing
you.
Your magic. We do have one last bit of magic for you guys. Some musical medicine from Dynasty Electrik. And this song is called Floating Around the Sun. Till next time, journey well. Love you all so, so much. Before we share the musical performance, I'd like to take a moment to tell you a bit about our exciting new Optimystic Manor online retreat and play shop experience. If you are craving connection, convenience, and consistency while experiencing powerful transformational practices, you can now join me and over a dozen Optimystics here at the Mystic Manor for online retreat-style play shops 2 times a day, 7 days a week. In addition, there are also several other options to join this re-membership and experience virtual community here at the Mystic Manor above and beyond the play shops, such as receiving access to a private Facebook group with regular exercises that we all participate in and reflect about together, as well as regular live interactive Q&A sessions with me and some of the other facilitators. So if you're interested in joining us online for an ongoing virtual retreat experience here at the Mystic Manor, go today and check out patreon.com/WeAreOptimystic to learn more and sign up to become a more integral part of the Optimystic family. We're super, super excited to have you join in the magic with us that's happening here every single day at the Mystic Manor and to expand our community together. Also, if you were inspired or touched by the retreat guests' shares in this episode, you also have the opportunity to come and experience a transformational week-long retreat immersion at the Mystic Manor in person here in Venice, California, with me and the rest of the Optimystic family. However, as you can imagine, spots are super limited, so if you feel called to spend a week co-creating magic together, as well as to join me here on the Optimystic stage, check out optimystic.tv to explore the possibilities further, and be sure to schedule a call with one of our Optimystic booking elves to seize this unique opportunity while spots are still available at calendly.com/mystic deal. All of these links are in the comments below. Otherwise, look forward to seeing you all here at the Mystic Manor.
Fading out. to pass me by in a stone that I found. Let it fall to the ground, and I looked up to the sky, and now I see what I dream, the colors of this time, and now
Listen.